Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. Welcome to Bronzeville.
Thank you.
So I've been in food service for about 20 years, so a little longer than the bio. So 20 to 25 years, actually. And I think every year we start to think about food service from a different angle. I had the pleasure of speaking with Ms. Robbie on the phone for a little while. It was supposed to be a 15-minute conversation, and it just turned into, oh, man, do you remember this, and you remember that? But when you start to think about food service, we think about food, kitchens, stories. And when I read the cookbook spoke to all of those things, right? So tonight we're going to take a little ride. We'll talk about food, but really we're going to have a conversation. Because if you understand good cooking and food, a majority of it happens in the kitchen, right? So even instead of the dining room table, most people pile all in the kitchen. You have a party at home, people pile all in the kitchen. So we just talk about the significance of all that. But I would love for you guys to give Ms. Robbie a big round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you so much for coming out, because it's actually cold out there. So I really want to thank you. I mean, I didn't come prepared. I'm like, oh, Chicago's got to be hot. I was wrong. So thank you so much for coming out.
So as I was telling everyone, you know, when we start to talk about food and the relationship with food, you have this thing in your book, and it's about oral tradition. You want to talk about oral tradition a little bit?
Well, like he said, at my house, everything happened in the kitchen. I mean, I don't think we ever used our dining room table.
Yeah.
We had a table in the kitchen, and that's where everything happened. When Mama was cooking, we were in there tasting, helping Mama prepare. So that was the center of our family. I mean, that was the gathering of our family. We solved our problems there in the kitchen. Everybody cried. You got whooped in the kitchen. So everything happened in the kitchen. So this is the origin of my story about soul food. My mom was an excellent cook, and I was the oldest of nine. So I had to help her all the time. And when I would come home from school, we ate dinner at 3:30. We got out of school at 3 o'clock. When we got home, dinner was ready. You didn't have the opportunity to say, I don't want that, I want a McDonald's. You had to eat what Mama fixed. And so when I would come home, she was like, Robbie, go up there and fix that cornbread. Or Robbie, go up there and finish frying that chicken. So everything happened in the kitchen. Okay.
So when you start to think about then and now, what's different?
Now is that I'm doing the cooking and looking for somebody to help me. Mama's gone on to glory. So
right.
She's looking down saying, I told you, girl, you're just going to have to do that one day, and this is something that you need to know. So now I'm an adult, and I appreciate all the things that my mom taught me, because they're helping me now. So I say to kids all the time, listen to your mother and your father. But since I'm a woman, listen to your mom. Mom knows what she's talking about. Yes.
So historically, I remember growing up in the kitchen with my grandmother, right? And there was a flour can.
Yes.
She probably still has the can.
Probably
right?
So.
I stood on the can, and I would hold on to her apron because I couldn't get too close to the stove.
Yes.
And I remember when we were cooking, I was paying attention to everything she was doing, right?
That's right.
The one thing she never did was measure anything.
That's right.
So how do you cook?
I cook to taste.
Okay.
I mean, for my cookbook, I had to make it so I could use, you know, measurements. But I cook to taste. If I got a pot this big, I just keep dumping and then tasting. And then I'm like, this need a little bit something else. Then I go start finding things to put in it. And when I get there, I know it. So if it tastes good to me, I think it tastes good to everybody else. But if it ain't right, I ain't going to put it out there. No, don't put that out there. It needs a little something else. And so I have to find that something else. Yes.
How hard is it to find people? Well, we talked about lack of talent. When we started to think about this industry and how many people go to culinary school and how many people think that they can cook.
You know what?
How hard is that?
It is so hard to find people that are passionate about their trade, their craft. It's so hard. They want to say that they're a cook, and they want to come in and throw it together and then put it out to the customers. I don't like that. I mean, like I said, it has to taste good to me first. Has to present, you know, your eye is what you want. When you see food and it looks good, then you want to taste it. But if it looks all crappy, nobody wants to eat that. I go into restaurants sometime and the steam tables are nasty And that happens at mine too.
Right.
But see, I don't just sit there. If you know me, you know I cuss and fuss. So when I go around that steam table and it's crappy, I'm like, clean that steam table. I'm like, well, we had a line. I don't care. Stop it and clean it off, because your eyes is what, you know, leads to your stomach, your appetite. So everything has to look presentable. And it's hard to find people that are passionate about that. They just want to say, I'm a cook.
Right.
And get in there. I want them to treat my business like it's their own.
Because I find a lot of people, and some of you guys may have some family members who have attended culinary school, and the first thing they do when they get that chef jacket is say, I'm a chef.
I'm a chef. That's right. It don't make you a chef because you left school.
No, right.
I've had so many people from culinary schools trying to give them, because they have to do their
stars.
Yeah, all that, you know, first. So I bring them in, and then they're totally... They just want to go strictly by the book, cook the meat, whatever. If it says an hour, they cook it out. Because it says an hour doesn't mean it's done.
Right.
You got to test it, poke it, pull it, taste it, you know. Because you can't just follow the recipe and expect it to be right all the time. People say to me all the time, aren't you afraid they're going to steal your recipes? No.
No.
Because you could give me your cake recipe, and I make it, it won't turn out like yours. I got a friend that makes this phenomenal pound cake. Mm-hmm. She gave me the recipe. I can never get the cake done.
Yeah.
It's always a little spot in there that's not done. I'm not leaving it long enough. I'm rushing it.
Right.
It's something I'm doing wrong. So I don't worry about people stealing. In fact, I go around when I used to sing and the food was excellent. I'm like, what did you put in there? Not knowing that one day I was going to use his secret.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So... It's hard to find people that are dedicated to the craft. It really is.
Does cooking bring you pleasure?
Cooking brings me pleasure, and more pleasure comes when people say, "Oh, that was good."
Right.
They enjoyed it. It served their palate. So I love that. And when I walk around the restaurant, everybody, your food was delicious. Now, I don't get all good complaints now. You can't please everybody. But I try. I really do. And I love to cook. I love to cook. Now, I don't like to cook huge amounts anymore.
Okay.
Because it's a bit much, but I love to cook.
So, okay, so there's a trend, you know, with different types of cuisine,
yes,
right? And
yes.
So when you think of soul food,
mm-hmm.
what comes to mind?
Well, soul food to me is survival food. It comes with love. And as I grew up, my mom was able to make a meal out of anything.
Right.
So that to me is soul food. It doesn't matter if you're black, white, green, purple. You got your roots. Where you came from, and you know something, how your mom made a pot of soup. She took all the leftovers mm-hmm. and made. So it's a survival food, and we just call it soul food. It doesn't mean that because we're black,
right.
It's soul food. It's home cooking. That's all it is, home cooking, country cooking.
Now, there's several restaurants in Chicago now mm-hmm. that soul food is a big deal.
Okay.
There's a place downtown that sells pig ears.
Okay.
Right? So it used to be a food that people turned their nose up at.
Right.
But now there's a line outside waiting to get to that place, right?
Right, that's true.
Which is amazing to me because I grew up on that. My grandmother would say, go get that okra, go get that, you know, pig ears.
Yeah.
You know, and you feast it. I didn't like it, you know, when I think about it, I'm like, oh, I ate all that. But it was delicious food because it was cooked with care and passion, and you could tell.
Yes, and it was a meal. I mean, it's going around. If you see a restaurant with pig ears, people don't find them anymore.
Right.
I went down to Tina. They turned her schoolhouse into her museum, and they had a truck out there, and he had pig tails. And I'm like, I've only eaten pig tails boiled.
Oh, really?
So, you know, like you do a pig ear.
Oh, yeah.
So okay. I've only had them like that. So I walked up to them, I'm like, they got pig tails? And so it had like $2. So I'm like, what is he doing with this tail? So I walked up there and got a pigtail, and he barbecued it, not with the barbecue sauce. He smoked it on the grill.
Really?
With charcoal. It was delicious. I went back and got three more. And so I'm like, I've never had it before. It was nice and tastes just like pork rib, just like it. It all had a little skin around the tail. It was real crispy. In St. Louis, we eat pig snoots.
Oh,
I don't
yeah.
know if you do, but
yeah.
No,
yeah,
we eat
yeah,
them,
yeah,
and they're like a crackling. And so that was on the end of that little pork tail. So when I got home, I went to the butcher. I'm like, order me a case of pig tail. And honey, and so I sacked them up, put 10 in a package. Last Friday, every Friday, my brother-in-law does the barbecue at the restaurant. Throw a packet of pig tails on a...
Right.
Good. You got to try. If I had known about it, I would have had it in the book.
So that was like the original food truck, right?
Yes.
So somebody selling out of the back of that
car. Out of the back of the truck at her, it was a festival.
For was Tina it some Turner. Moonshine too?
Moonshine, yeah, but they didn't sell. They didn't advertise. You had to go in the back. They pass it around the corner. So. Yes, yes.
So talk about your career. So you were a backup singer.
Yes, that's how I started. With Ike and Tina, they're from St. Louis, and I sang around town, and it's amazing. At the time that we had our first hit record, mm-hmm. I was pregnant, Tina was pregnant, and another girl was pregnant in the group.
Wow.
We went in the studio and sang the record, Fool in Love, uh-huh. and it was a hit. And it was like, these pregnant girls made this hit. So actually, it was a bunch of us, six of us singing, but we didn't know it at the time.
Wow.
So that started my career as a professional. I mean, I sang around St. Louis for years as a backup. And then when we got the hit, we went on the road. And eventually, we moved to California because there was more music happening and more things. So when out there, I stayed. I sang for about 30, 40 years. When I got to California, I found out that I could sing behind other artists and make as much money. So after about 10 years, I left Ike and Tina and went with Dr. John. Mm-hmm. And after 20 or 30 years singing, I developed a lung problem. And the doctor said, well, when I get on stage, I would sing. I had a lung biopsy.
Okay.
So where they took the specimen from, it never healed. So when I would get on stage to sing, it would open back up. They explained it was like an inner tube with a hole in it. And so when that pressure would collapse my lung. So the doctor's like, well, you got to either stop singing or have the surgery. I didn't want to have the surgery. So I moved home. I quit singing, moved home to St. Louis. Okay. I had a little dog, and he ran out in the street, and I screamed for him, and it collapsed my lung again.
Oh, wow.
So I had to have the surgery. But I quit singing for, you know, 3 or 4 years and moved back to St. Louis. So I'm like, well, I didn't die, so I got to do something, you know. So I'm like, well, everybody likes my cooking. I took culinary in school, but we didn't call it, wasn't culinary, it was commercial cooking.
Okay.
And so I went to trade school, and so that's where all the teachers ate, in the tea room, and that's where the band students cooked in the tea room. It was
okay.
called commercial cooking. So I'm like, well, let me try my hand at that. And that's how I got into the restaurant business.
So were you the best cook on the road or the only cook on the
road? The best cook. I refuse to say anything else. The best. Like I said, I was the oldest of nine, and the other girls had big families, but they couldn't cook. So everybody loved we had a hot plate and a skillet because everything was segregated back in those days and wasn't a lot of restaurants to go into. So when we would look up on a motel with a kitchenette or a room that was big enough, honey, we'd hook. I could make some meals in a skillet. We would do fried potatoes, fried pork chop, fried chicken. We used to do lots of Kraft macaroni and cheese in the can.
Oh, wow.
So just open the can and pour in there steaks, corn, I mean, just spaghetti, one potters. So we did all that, and I was the best cook. I was the best cook. So that's how I decided, well, let me try my hand at it.
So I have another question. Okay, so when I look at movies like Ray, and they used to talk about the Chitlin' Circuit.
Yes.
Okay, so explain that.
The Chitlin' Circuit was the circuit that every musician played, especially black. I can only speak for black because I don't know what white did. But we had a little circuit that we all played. James Brown, Bobby Bland, Ike and Tina, all the groups. So if you played here tonight, I came the next weekend.
Okay.
So it was a circuit. And we called it the Chitlin' Circuit. We only had maybe 3 or 4 hotels.
Okay.
Even if James Brown was in the hotel, we have to stay on our bus until they checked out and they cleaned up the rooms. Then we'll check in.
The same hotel?
Same hotel. And
wow.
Before we left, then Bobby Bland would come around with his review, and they'd have to wait on us to get out. So that was the little, we called it the Chitlin' Circuit. And plus, people sold food out of their homes.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask.
You know,
what was the tie-in with the Chitlins?
Okay. The theaters, like you all had a theater here. What you have? What was your theater?
Regal right. Theater, right?
It was always Regal somebody, someplace they would come around and sell dinners.
Okay.
And we would buy that. And it was that same little circuit. We did it forever.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, because when we start to think about tradition and history. Mm-hmm. Like history has a, it's repeating itself all over again.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah. So like now, when you look at the artists and what they're doing and how some artists take their celebrity and they go into the restaurant industry,
yes.
And not just because it's something fancy to do, but usually there's some tie to it.
Right. Usually they got a following.
Right.
And people, if you hear Jay-Z got a restaurant, they're just going to automatically go. It doesn't mean that it's great.
Right.
But it's Jay-Z's restaurant and everybody's going to go to it. And the musicians of today are much smarter. I don't want to say much smarter, but they have more opportunities than
more
we
access.
Have. And they're doing bigger things. They're opening restaurants and starting clothing lines and liquor and all that stuff. So they're making a ton of money. Right. Where when we were out there, we didn't make a lot of money and we didn't have the opportunities. So we had to make our own way. And whatever you thought that you could work at, that's what you did. I mean, I used to go to flea markets and mm-hmm. set up booths, and I'd look around and see what was new and buy me a bunch of it and take it to flea markets. I mean, I did a lot of things to try and survive because, right. like I say, if you didn't die, you still got a chance.
Right.
Still got a chance.
So why restaurants? So you did all that?
I picked restaurants because I could cook, you know, and like I said, and people always loved it. And when I went back to St. Louis, the little restaurants was little dinky places and, you know, nasty. And mm-hmm. I hate to say that, but it was the truth. So I figured, if I came back home, made a like, a, I don't want a place that you got to dress up to come to.
Right.
I want you to feel comfortable and make the food excellent, not just good, excellent food that they will come. And that's what I believed in. And that's what I did. And I did a lot of praying. Now, don't think I just got out there and did that, but I did walk by faith. I didn't have any money. Like I said, I had stopped singing. I went to school to become a dialysis technician.
Okay.
So I could work and make some money. And then after I got to a point where I couldn't make any more money without going back to school, I'm like, well, what can I do now? Then I decided I'll try my restaurant. And it was not easy. I would go out to garage sales and everything commercial I would see, excuse me, I would buy it, put it to the side, put it in my garage or put it someplace. And I really, it was a club, a white club in St. Louis that mm-hmm. I worked with Ike and Tina. And they had closed that club. And I called them and I'm like, do you have any table and chairs? And this is 40 years ago. You got in those tables and chairs left that I used to, when we used to sing there? He said, yeah, I got them all. I'm like, you want to sell some of them? He sold them to me for $5.
Oh, wow.
$5 a chair. So I would buy as many chairs as I could buy this week and then put them up and then go back next week and buy $15 tables. And I just kept doing that until I got to the point where I started looking for a spot.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody was like, you going to quit your job? Going to quit your job? So, you know, nobody's going to encourage you. I always say that. Any dream, I don't care how old you are or what, you have to remember, this is your dream. This is your desire. And you're never too old to start anything. I'm 76. I roller skate. I ride bikes. I drive. When people are like, you want me driving? Miss Daisy don't need no driver. Look, now maybe you can help with the car note, but Miss Daisy don't need no driver, honey. And I go because I don't like people. I don't like to wait on people. So I drive myself. I do everything that I want to do. And now when I get ready to leave home, somebody like, don't pick that bag up. Well, where was you at last month? I picked it up then. You know, so I just do everything. So I encourage people to just do whatever you want to do until you die. And then I don't know what happens then because I don't care. I don't want to die. Excuse me, this hair is getting in my face. So, but I always say, follow your dream. But one thing, don't expect nobody to be on that dream with you because they're not. My heart was broken so many times when I got ready to start my restaurant. I was doing dialysis for the hospital, like I went to school to do that. And I finally got this man, and I tell people that I do believe in miracles. I was driving to work, and I saw this building like this with a big old police sign on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't go that day. So maybe about 4 or 5 months, I told my patient, I said, I saw a sign. Now, in the meantime, I'm kind of skipping around. I used to make my pies and take them to the barbecue places and put them in there, and they would sell them for me. So I saw this sign. I told my patient, I said, I saw a building that I'm going to try and get. And so it was 4 or 5 months later, I went in this building, and somebody was in there. But I tell you, that building had a police sign on it. I walked in there, and I said, hello. They people had cookies piled up to the ceiling. And I'm like, these people look like they've been here. And so I said, hello, and an Italian man came from the back. And I said, did you just move here? He said, no. I said, no, I don't want this man to think I'm crazy. I know I saw that sign. He says, no, this is a family business. We've been here 28 years. Now wow. I'm feeling real stupid because I know in my heart I saw that sign. So I said, well, I mean, did you just move maybe 4 or 5 months ago? He said, no, ma'am, 28 years we've been here. So I felt stupid. I said, well, I make pies at home, and I was looking for a place, and I was wondering if you had any equipment to sell. Now, I don't know where the hell that came from. But that's what I said to him. 5 or 6 months later, this man called me. I gave him my number. Hey, Robbie, this is Jim down at the bakery. You know, we got a few things to sell. I go down there. I still ain't got no money. He had like a big old freezer, a big conveyor oven. I had never even been inside of a bakery. Never been. He had this conveyor belt where they roll their pie crust out.
Right.
And I said, but you know what? I haven't even found a place. That's what I said to him. I said, but call me if you move. And sure enough, 3 or 4 months later, hey, Robbie, this is Jim down at the bakery.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to move. I'm like, so now I still ain't got no money, no money. But I'm like, I done told this man all this, I gotta follow through. So about 2 months I waited and I said, let me see if this man moves. Sure enough, I drove by, he had moved, had a little card in the window with his forwarding address and number. I called him up. I said, Jim, this is Robbie. Do you think they'll, now I'm looking for a place for $200 or $300 to rent. I said, do you think they will let me have this place? He said, I'm going to tell them you're my friend. I said, well, how much do you think he's going to rent it for? He said, probably $1,000. $1,000? Oh, Lord. So it's so amazing how God works, because the man that I was doing dialysis, the patient that I was dialyzing, the mother of the man that owned the shopping center had been his first girlfriend.
Wow.
Now, that's just, I mean, it, so all this was just came into play. And he told the man to let me have the place. And he let me have it for $500. I told him, I said, you know what? I might be late with your rent, but I'll never miss a month. I was so excited, so excited. I mean, my heart, I got my best girlfriend. And when I got the keys, I ran into her, said, come on, go see. I got the place. When she walked in, she like, oh, my God, what are you going to do with this? She didn't have my vision. The floor was nasty. It was all dirty and everything. She could not see my vision. And that hurt me, because I wanted her to be excited as I was. That's why I say, nobody is your dream. Nobody's going to believe in it. And she did not see it. And that hurt me so bad. Everybody I asked for money, they was like, I love to help you, but I don't have any money. Nobody helped me. Nobody said, I don't have nothing but a penny, and you can have that. Nobody said that. I would get so disgusted, I would go home at night and cry. Lord, won't nobody help me? When I had money, I helped everybody. Nobody's helping me. Oh, help me, Jesus, help me. I word the Lord to death. I prayed all the time. Every day was a new day. Everything's okay? Yeah. All right, because you can't get no money here. We can call 911. We got no money. Are you okay? You okay? Oh, okay. All right, okay. So, I mean, I have had so many disappointments, but you have to turn those stumbling blocks into stepping stones. And I don't care what your passion is. So that's why I keep going saying to people, don't expect anybody to help you. Couldn't get no loan from no bank. I just walked by faith. Like I said, bought a chair, bought a spoon, bought a plate. And finally, when the time comes to open, they got so many codes and stuff. And you got to do your homework and make sure all that stuff,
right.
You know,
yeah.
That is there, because I had taken this bakery that was a bakery and turned it into a soul food restaurant, not knowing that you need a different hood system,
yeah.
From what bakery do, because I'm cooking grease and that's not strong enough. And I didn't know all that. So I'm waiting out on the inspectors. The inspector come and said that hood will not work.
It's got to go.
Got to go. So now that's $22,000 or more, depending on the system. I'm like, oh, God, here I go crying again, worrying the Lord, Jesus. And eventually, some kind of way, I got it. Then after I got ready to inspect again, I didn't have a floor sink.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have a grease trap. So all these things you need to know before you try and attempt to open a business, because you're going to have to do them. So every time, I mean, it was so many things, I just kept doing whatever they said. I'm like, eventually they're going to run out of things, and I'm going to open. And that's exactly what happened. And then the day of my opening, I was scared to death. So scared. My heart was just beating out of my space, and I had a couple of friends that helped me. They would run outside, come on in here, come on in here. You know, they would encourage people to come in, and then they would try the food, and they liked it, and they would tell somebody else. And it just went on, and now it's been like 20 years. We have like 5-7 restaurants. And so, thank you. And I always say to people, you know, God is good. What he does for one child, he won't do no more for one than he'll do for the other. But you got to know what you want. You got to be willing to work. I just took over, didn't I?
No, it's okay. Is it okay? It's okay.
So, I encourage everybody to try your dream. I mean, go for it. I don't care what it is. I was in the line the other day, and I said to the lady, she gave her in the voting line, and she handed this little kid a bottle, and seemed like music played out the bottle. I said, is that a musical milk bottle? She said, you just gave me an idea for a business. I'm like, that's right. So when she turned, but it was her phone in her pocket that was running, but all I could see was the little kid turning the bottle up. And I said, that bottle plays music. She said, Ms. Robbie, you just gave me an idea. So we might see that on the market. You never know. I always wonder, why couldn't I thought of toilet paper or a toothpick, something that everybody needs? That's what I spend my brains trying to think of, something that everybody
right.
needs. And it can happen to you. It can happen to you just like it did me.
Talk about the show.
Oh, the show.
Right.
The show is about my family. It's about a black family in the Midwest in business. And the struggles we have, the ups and the downs. Me and my son fight all the time. And this is real. This is really real. I mean, I'm taking my son to court. And I mean, I'm not saying it to be funny. This is true. He's my son. I love him. But I have a brand to protect. And he wants to open up restaurants like you pop peanuts. And it doesn't work like that. But he's young and ambitious. And he thinks you can just open them up. And he thinks he's entitled. He didn't pay the dues that I paid, but I'm, you know, this is my mama. I can open a restaurant if I want to. So we're battling there on the show. I lost my grandson last year, so that's on the show.
Right.
I went back to singing after 30 years. Did a concert in L.A. I went in the recording studio.
Mm-hmm.
I got 2 songs out on iTunes, so by the time the show, look, 76, I was shaking my tail feather. They're like, Miss Bobby, can you steal that? I said, it ain't broke, so I can do it. You know what I'm saying? So I'm just having a good time at this age in my life, and I always try to think positive about everything. And when people come up and say, Miss Bobby, I was going to give up, but you inspired me, I love to hear that. And when they're telling me that, that inspires me. So I just keep going, honey. They're going to have to scoop me up from somewhere and bury me, because I will be gone.
When we were on the phone, we talked about failures, right?
Failures, yes.
And you said that, correct me if I'm wrong, you said success is nothing if you can't talk about the failure.
That's right. I mean, how can you recognize the difference? I mean, you have to fail at something to be able to appreciate the success. And failing means nothing. If you don't try it, how would you fail? You got to try something, whatever it is. I encourage everybody. I failed so many times at so many things, some of them I forgot. But I did fall, you know what I mean? I've tried all kinds of business. I've had little flea markets. I've had just different things that I've done through, you know, in my life. I'm real estate.
Right.
And you have to be, I went to school for a hygienist. I never even used it one day, but I went to school and graduated. And so when I got finished school, I'm like, I ain't finna go stick my hand in nobody's mouth. And here I am. And here I am every day, spend a lot of money and time in the dentist's office. Wish I had stayed. But you get some, a lot of things, and everybody doesn't fail at everything. But there are some things that you have to appreciate. I always say turn them stumbling blocks into stepping stones, because you will appreciate your life. And don't be afraid. You're going to be afraid. Like every time I open a restaurant, I'm scared, just as scared as I was the first time, because you don't know if it's going to work. But you got to be encouraged and get on out there and take that step. Just, it's just something to do. And if that don't work, wake up tomorrow with another idea and keep on going.
What's next?
Next for me, well, I'm back in the music business, but I say to people, I want to put a hotel next to my restaurant, so when you get tired and sleepy and eat, go next door and go to bed. So that's my next endeavor to do that. And I'm trying to think of something now that I don't have to be there every day. I don't have to be, but I'm such a hands-on person. I told my son, I said, I want to make sure I had my tea out, I got my cookbook. I want to make sure that people don't have to come to St. Louis to get these things, that they can be selling all around the world every day. And then maybe I won't have to work so hard anymore. But I do enjoy doing what I do. So I'm saying today, I might wake up tomorrow and say, I'm going to do something else.
Right.
Until you get out there and do it, you know, just an idea.
Do you like the camera following you around?
Well, the camera following me around, sometimes it could be a bit much. You know, if you drop that bread, you can't pick it up.
She's just playing.
I'm just kidding. Just having fun. But there's a lot of things you can't do. You look, one day I had these gloves on, and I was preparing something, and then I took the gloves off, and then I put some gloves on to do something else. And this one lady, and then I think I did about three or four things in that glove, and this one lady said, Ms. Robbie been had them gloves on a long time. I'm like, oh, Lord. So now on the camera, I got to change them gloves on every second, because I know people are watching that kind of stuff, which I would change them if I needed. But if I picked up this cup with the gloves, I probably wouldn't change it right then. But people are saying, she picked up that cup and didn't even change them gloves. So there's a lot of things that you can't do with the cameras, and they're pretty cool. I mean, if you say don't put it, when I get to cussing and fussing, I'm like, get the camera out of my face. They're messing up my food. You know? So they're pretty good. They know what to show and what not to. They want to make you look good.
Well, this has definitely been more than a pleasure.
Oh, for thank us. You. And thank you all again for coming out. This mic, now I've had a lot of mics, but this is the first. They don't like it. Me.
So I think at this time we're going to open it. Is it time now to open it up to the audience?
Okay.
So, guys, if you have any questions right now, now we can take some questions. We have someone with mics.
Okay.
All right, you touched on this earlier, but one of the questions I had, because, you know, I saw the commercial about the upcoming episodes that's about to come out, and you was getting on, Tim, about open up all these restaurants. So what I was going to ask, did he have plans to open up a restaurant here in Chicago?
You don't say it too loud. Okay. Don't say it too loud. He might be outside listening. That's what he does. He scope all around where people say, why don't you come to Houston? And next thing you know, Tim, Mom, I'm going to Houston. I'm like, Tim, don't go to Houston. And then next thing I know, he's down in Houston and opening up a restaurant. So he probably will. I mean, I want him to do what he's doing, but I wanted him to do it with my permission, because I think I know a little bit more than him. You just came home, you know, it's like people, I tell everybody, I found the land, bought the property, built the house.
Right.
Now everybody want a room. You know, nobody did no work, they all want a room. And I always tell Tim, you just came to the table, the pie was already cooked. You know, don't tell me what to do. So, but I'm proud of him being ambitious. But I hate I'm the one that we're fighting against, me and my son. But business is business.
Yeah. Okay. One more question.
Okay.
You look so healthy, and I think you have a beautiful family, by the way. But what do you do to stay healthy?
I don't know how to answer that. I got an aunt that's got beautiful skin. I'm like, what do you do with your skin? She said. You know what? I just get up, keep going, and I do try to take care of myself the best that I can. And I rest. All I do is work and rest. That's all I do. Anything I do is involved with my business. So.
We have another one.
Okay.
Hi. Miss Robbie, I've never cooked gumbo, and I'm going to attempt it.
Oh, honey, I'm
this holiday. So when I opened up your cookbook, and I looked at the recipe, and I did look at it.
Okay.
I noticed that there weren't any, like, the ingredients for the roux.
The roux.
So well, you know, don't have to give away your secrets.
No, I'm going to tell you because I wasn't aware that the roux, I just take a little flour, brown it, really, and I brown my onions and celeries and all that in my roux and put it in there. See, I wasn't aware of that. See how you learn something every minute? And I wasn't aware that the recipe for the roux wasn't in there. I was not aware of
you
that.
You want to add a spice or two just to let me know? Aside from the salt and pepper.
Right. You know. Well, I use all the seasoned Cajun season and stuff like, and what is it called?
You use nutmeg in yours?
No, not in my roux. And not in my filet gumbo. I buy that. Thank you. Couldn't even think. So I buy that in the store, and I put that in there. And I put shrimp, lobster, crab, chicken, andouille sausage, or any kind of sausage you want to. I just put everything in there, and I just keep adding. And at the end, I add a little okra, you know, for mine and stuff. And I'll keep it brown. I don't like tomato gumbo. I keep mine brown. But I just keep adding that filet gumbo until it gets to the taste that I want. And pour a little already. Got some bacon grease laying around. Pour a little of that in there.
We're going to make some on Sunday. How about that?
Yeah, any other questions? I fix it once a year at my house.
Where do you go at?
Where?
Where are your favorite places to eat?
Any place that, I just ask people, like in Chicago today, I've had pastrami. I've had, I just go any place, anybody say the food is good, because I like to try it.
Well, this has been so inspirational. I'm so glad I came out tonight.
Thank you.
But retirement, do you see that in your future? Is that on your agenda at all?
Retirement?
Just retiring, yeah.
Didn't you hear me say they're going to scoop me up? And see, that's my son thing. Mama, you need to stay home. But this is my livelihood. I love going into the restaurant. I love hugging my customers and talking to them and inspiring them. They inspire me, so I don't see retirement, but I would like to go to Vegas or Jamaica once in a while. I haven't been able to do that since I've been doing the show because we're tied up so much. But I love what I do, and I just continue to do it. I would like to get my cornbread in Walmart. Now, I'm going to tell you this story. Patti LaBelle beat me, and I love Patti. There's nothing wrong with it. But I told my son and Mr. Bussey, I need to put my sweet potato pies in the store. I make an excellent sweet potato pie. This has been going on for 6 or 7 years. And last year, Patty comes up with this pie. All over every place. I am so mad at it. So Walmart don't need, or what is it, Walmart?
Yeah, this I think pie. It's Walmart.
They don't need no more pie, so I send them some cornbread. So I'm praying that they take my cornbread. So we don't know, we'll see. So that's for my next venture. I'm trying to get them to take. I make these little loaves of cornbread. And it's hard to find good cornbread in the store.
Yeah,
it is. So I make these little loaves, and they're real crispy and everything, and the inside is good. Buttermilk cornbread. And so I send them that. And so we'll see if they take it. Yeah.
Any more questions?
More of a statement. The recipe to your roux is in your book. It's on page 31, step 2.
Oh, okay. See that? Thank you, baby.
She was setting you up.
Yeah, right. I didn't know that. You know, when you look at those things, I got to take time and really, really read it. A story, The Church of God in Christ is in St. Louis. So I have the printer print this banner, says, Miss Robbie and Sweetie Pies, welcome the Church of God in Christ. Now, I'm being nice. I want them to know I appreciate them. One lady, tell Miss Robbie she got the sign wrong. It's the Church of God in Christ. I'm like, oh, okay. I didn't know the difference, but they said it. And I didn't print the sign, so I didn't make a mistake. I just told him what I wanted. So sometimes we don't go, and I just was in a hurry to get the sign up. So I never really looked at it because I know what I told him. So it was a possibility that it wasn't in there, and I wasn't aware. Okay, but you wrong. That's right. You sure did.
We have a question over here.
Now, Ms. Robbie, you said you had a vision. I'm over here.
Where are you?
Right here. You said you had a vision. Now, when you finally start to see your vision come to light, and you said you had friends that didn't see your vision as well, when you start to see your vision come to pass, how did you welcome those friends? Like, what was your feelings towards them? What did you do once they start? I know they tried to come back around, so what did you do?
That's right. That's right. You know what I said? They're like, ain't, a lot of people's like, ain't nobody gonna eat no fried chicken. You trying to do soul food? You need to do a salad bar. At that time, salad bars was becoming popular.
Right.
And now I look at them like, nah, 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 nah. You don't know what you're talking about. I know something. So that's what I say to them. That greasy chicken is going good. Oh, somebody else? Okay.
I'm just wondering, if you were with Ike and Tina Turner over the time, the movie that they made about her.
Yes.
What is your impression of the movie versus the reality?
A lot of the movie is right. But one thing, Ike never hit her in front of us. We knew it the next day. I thought she was went into a Mack truck. I never saw him hit her, so I can never say that. Right. But we knew they had their fights and stuff. But he never did it in front of us. This was something that always happened in their room, and we'll see the results the next day. And my thing was, I was like a sister to her. And when you're there, you don't want to see her hurt and stuff like that. Oh, we used to try to encourage, why don't you leave? But see, you can't tell a woman when to leave her man. She has to wait until she makes up her own mind. And that's what happened. But it was a good life for us because we all left home together. And one thing about Ike, he paid you every Sunday.
Did he?
Every Sunday. And I learned a lot of lessons being out there. I try and apply them to my business because even though there was a marriage thing, he was a businessman. He really was a businessman. And now that I have a business, when you're depending on other people, and that's threatened. I would never beat up anybody, but this was his wife. And so when she would threaten to do certain things, then they would end up in a fight. I mean, I might go to work today so I can relate in a cook like, I need a raise. You better raise up out. Yeah, I ain't had no good customers or nothing, and you come and asking for a raise. So I understand now how this was his business, and he was depending on all these people, and he was threatened. He was an insecure man. He really was. So, but she loved him for years, and then when she left, she left. Some of the movies right, some of it's not. Okay.
Any more questions? Okay.
Yes, I want to say this has been, you've just truly inspiring, and I'm so glad I came. I came here with my mom, and she is your biggest fan. I can call her on a Saturday. Don't call. I'm watching Sweetie Pie. Watching Sweetie Pie.
That's right.
And she watched all of them throughout the. So I am so glad that I came along because I truly am inspired, and I think you're truly an inspiration for young women and to kind of just go for it. And I always let fear kind of prohibit me from doing, taking that next step forward. So I want to thank you and I appreciate that. The question is, you said you have 7 restaurants.
Yes.
Are they all in Missouri? Are they in different states? Well, I heard so. And then also, do they target the similar audience? I know you said originally you wanted more of a casual. Do you have upscale? Like, tell me about the branding of that.
They're all on the same scale. I mean, some, as I go, I learn to decorate different. I do a little better in the decorations as I go. But they're all basically the same. We got 5 in St. Louis and 2 in Los Angeles. So, and they're all the same recipes they're supposed to be. I say that. So, and then as I go, I decorate different. It's not like McDonald's. You're going to see the red and white sign or whatever. We just do according to the area. And some, like in California, everybody is healthy, trying to eat healthy. But they stand in line for that grease. It's like they do everything else. So we've kind of put a few things, like we might not put pork in the greens. We use turkey and green beans out there, use right. chicken in them and stuff like that. So we kind of adapt to the area. So because we need the customers, so we got to give them what they want. Yeah. But thank you, Mom, for following us. Thank everybody. Thank you all so much. You are an inspiration to me. Like, I got here today, I'm like, a book signing out. And it's cold. I hope these people coming out. Because it is cold here, I tell you.
It's not cold yet.
I know. I won't be back until the summer. You can believe that. I tell you. Yeah, that's what everybody's saying. Oh, wow.
So.
All right.
Do we have any other questions?
Okay.
I was under the impression that it was the Sweetie Pies in Memphis. What
well,
happened?
There's a story there. I went to Memphis, came to St. Louis. Miss Robbie, if you come, we got a spot right in front of the FedEx. I don't know, what's the ball team that plays there? Whatever. We got a spot there. All you got to do, we'll fix up the building. All you got to do is buy your fixtures and furniture and come down. I go down there, spend a whole lot of money, put up a sign, $38,000 sign, buy all my equipment, take it down, because I know how to buy used now, I'm smarter. I don't buy everything new, I know how to hustle around. Get all these trucks, take them down there, set up this restaurant. A sprinkler system was broke, the main stack was broke, the building had mold in it. I paid people to come in and do things, and the people that owned the building, they never fixed it up. So
oh, wow.
I ended up having to get a lawyer to fight them. In fact, I'm still fighting them. Still fighting because they're trying to still make me come there with under those conditions, and I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. So the sign is still now. I got the lawyer trying to give me the right to go take my sign down. So they don't need a sign on the empty building. I could use that sign. That's right. I could bring it up here. It'll look good. It'll look good hanging on one of these buildings. That's right.
So we have a question over here.
We got one more question.
Okay.
I'm just sitting down, so I don't know if it was answered. Are you planning on coming to Chicago?
Well, my son will. Tim will. But I wouldn't mind coming to Chicago. I don't like cold, I'm telling y'all. When I moved back from California to St. Louis, I said I had to be on drugs because it's cold there, too. It's cold there. I like hot. So I don't think I'll be coming to Chicago. But if Tim opens one, I'll come.
Well, we'll make sure that she comes here. How about that?
Yeah, I'll be back here.
She'll come to Peachy. Right. Come to Brownsville.
Yes. Yes.
Well, listen, it has been beyond my pleasure.
Thank
you.
Know, so
having
much
you here. I mean, can we get a round of applause, please?
And for you. God bless you all. Bless you. Bless you so much. And I say go for your dream. I don't care what it is, making a quilt, lemonade stand. I mean, you know what? And I talk so much, it's a shame. But I do talk. I used to go listen to motivation speakers. And I went to, I'm old, so Reverend Ike. And
oh,
I went
wow.
to see them. And they were passing like those metal buckets down the aisle. And they was filling up with money. And they'd go down this aisle. I'm like, Lord, he ain't doing nothing but talking. And that day he said, I know some of you all can cook better than Kentucky Fried. Why ain't you rich?
Wow.
So that's my question I leave with you today. Why aren't you rich? You can make cookies. You can make quilts. You can make plants. You can make, there's something that you can do. God gave you some type of talent. You just got to bring it out. And you're going to be scared. Take the leap. Take the leap because it's your dream, nobody else's. And I know you could do it. I know you could do it. You'll be surprised. You'll really be surprised.
I'm going to add on that. Take that leap back to Peaches.
Right.
So you guys come here tomorrow or Sunday or whenever. Please come on back to Brownsville if you have not been.
That's right.
Thank you, guys.
I love this restaurant.